Welcome, everyone. I'm Sam from Caligula's Horse, and on the couch back there, you can see Jim, also of Caligula's Horse.
Hello.
Joined by Jared Adlam, who was the audio engineer on Rise Radiant, and is also a good friend and a regular collaborator of ours.
And studio punching bag.
The poor guy. So what we thought we'd do is we thought we'd get together in the place that we actually recorded a lot of the last album, Rise Radiant, and kind of do a little bit of a walk through some of the sessions. The idea being kind of giving you some insight into how we construct our arrangements, how we build our productions, and kind of what kind of happens under the hood a little bit. A lot of the parts of the songs that maybe don't get to shine as much because they're not lead vocals or rhythm guitar parts.
The important bits.
The important bits. So that said, what we're going to do first is we're going to look through The Tempest, the first song on Rise Radiant.
I mean, we've sort of talked about it before, but, you know, it's very much a song about sort of overcoming, which is a theme throughout the whole album. And it's particularly one about, you know, acknowledging that you can sort of free yourself from the chains of whatever's around you, including the ones that you've built for yourself. And that you can do it. You can make it. We all can.
Especially relevant right now.
Especially now.
So there's a problem that you always run into at the beginning of a record, and it's how you actually open that record, how you make that first statement that, you know, sort of sets the scene for all of the rest of it. The equivalent, I suppose, of like the first line in a novel or the, you know, first line in a poem or something. We decided pretty early on that we wanted a song that was going to start with a bang. Admittedly, we've done that for the last couple of albums, I suppose.
Yeah.
But this is a really good example of that. So do you want to just play the start of this, Jared, and we'll talk about what is happening there. Yeah, so I mean, obviously a lot of parts. It just occurred to me that there's one other thing I probably should add just before we start digging into it, and that's that the album was produced by me. Jared and I recorded it. Jared is the sort of lead engineer on the record, and Jens Bogren, our longtime hero, mixed the record. Now, the other thing that we've got, funnily enough, is the demo up the very top there, which might be interesting to, I mean, maybe we even start there. So, I mean, besides sounding a little bit flatter, it's mostly there. Now, this is actually something that we've done since, do you reckon, the very beginning, Jim? I can't really think of a time when we didn't do this.
Except for on Moments, like the first album, where the process that we undergo for demos was basically the production for the album.
Yeah, very true. Very true. So I think from all the way back during the River's End sessions, we would basically do full production kind of demos that would kind of meld into the actual production of the album, because a lot of those parts you can actually hear there. I don't think that synth sound changed too much, for example. Why don't we have a look at that? Let's have a look at what is playing that lead line in the intro here. Stop that. So let's jump down to the actual individual tracks. I think I remember using your Moog. I think there's some other stuff. We've got to find the Euro synth. That's the gold
so
here, right?
Here we have our lead guitars.
Yeah.
So what did you actually do there? You just double left and right?
So it's a left and right, and then it's also octaves. I mean, there's not really anything kind of fancy there. It really is just a matter of, you know, getting it all to line up as one part. But if we add to that the keyboards.
Keys.
Yeah, this is an interesting part. Maybe leave the pad out for the moment. We'll just do the melodic parts. Cool. It is the Moog. I knew it. All right. So that's either my
90s
sub fatty
hip-hop.
Or yeah. Totally. It's a cool sound though. That I actually really like doing those really smooth kind of portamento-y synths following guitar parts, because it ends up kind of getting rid of some of the attack, you know. It makes it sound quite liquid and quite smooth, and in something really rhythmic like this, I think that suits well. But that's kind of undermined almost by this guy, by the chorus.
Is that what I think
I like
it is?
That.
Is that what I think
like
it
that.
Is?
Is that an una quarta?
Is that an una quarta?
It might be. I'm kind of guilty for basically doubling everything with Nils Fram's amazing una quarta, the Native Instruments sample of that. I suspect that might actually be, hybrid keys. The other contact one. But either way, that's obviously there just to add a little bit of sort of rhythmic crispness and a bit of color. Because like I said, it was intended to sound big and vibrant rather than just like, you know, fat and heavy. Actually, a good comparison might be a song like Dream the Dead, right? Mm. Where it sort of comes in much darker and much heavier.
And we've also got this.
Ooh. That's a cool pad. I think that's absinthe by the sound of it. Actually, have we got notes? I feel like I may have put notes in as we went.
Not for the synths.
Oh, it's a shame.
Possibly in the original version without the consolidated file.
So you know where I want to go next. Let's jump to intro B. Now, this is where it gets really fun because there's some parts here that I don't particularly like on their own, I guess I'll say. Let's have a listen, if you would, Jared, to all of the layers. We could actually just listen to the stems maybe if you want. But this is the idea of this is where the theme for what becomes the main riff for the song, so where it's kind of established.
These things here, maybe?
Yeah, let's have a look at this. Maybe kill the rhythms. And then kill everything except for the synth.
That's the MVP.
Yeah,
club
so
banger.
So this was probably the longest running joke for this whole production because this is like a Euro like dance synth.
Yeah, we're literally auditioning for Eurovision in that one moment. That's all it is.
Now, look, this is one of these things. I remember getting the first mixes back from Jens and being like, and basically just over three odd increments of the mix, just saying you need to turn that down because you know I love it and it works really well in the context of the song, especially introducing that theme, but. I can't
too much.
Does sound, can't forget.
No, I take it back. That's
what's holding it together.
Yeah, that bass tone especially. But we'll talk about that, I think, when we get to the verse. So check out the keys here, I think. Now, that's really cool. So this is a technique that we actually used a lot throughout this album. It's actually something that I almost always do, where if you're going to take like a rhythm guitar part, it's kind of interesting to accentuate, say, like the transient nature of it with a synth, or like augment the kind of grain of the distortion with an organ, or just, you know, adding some kind of keyboard part that fills in something that the rhythm guitar can't really do. And when we hear all that together, if you just play them all together, the synth really... I can't imagine that riff without it now. It's a big part of it. Very cool. Very cool.
Very chunky.
Now, that's the kind of riff that I would regard as like, it's not a riff that fits very well on the guitar. You know what I mean? Like it's a riff that when you play it, it kind of feels a bit awkward. You're moving... Especially those little double slides and stuff. But it's the kind of thing that once you kind of add some keys and, you know, add some other elements to it, it starts to take shape as what it is. I guess what I'm saying is like, I can't really imagine that riff without the keys. It's kind of a part of it to me. Now, the iteration of that brings back another one of the themes off the top of my head. It brings back that tremolo picked line from before.
Yep.
Yeah. So, I mean, one of the biggest... kind of compositional approaches that we take in Seahorse is what you could call motivic development, I suppose. Like taking a motif and basically getting as much value out of it as you can, you know, putting it in different contexts, playing it in different ways on different instruments, you know, even transposing it, moving it around, reharmonizing it. I love the idea that if you've got a complicated progressive metal song, ostensibly progressive metal song, what ties it all together are these motifs that are repeated and that are iterated and, you know, that always kind of linger, maybe subconsciously, maybe not, in the listener's mind, linking the parts together. So they might seem really disparate, parts might be contrasting one another, but they're tied together by motifs. And you definitely see that a lot throughout these pieces. That's something that Jim and I spend a lot of time kind of working into the construction of our songs. And in fact, you could have a song that has a really strange or irregular structure, but which is tied together by motifs. Like that could be the single thread that kind of brings them together. So that's a bit of a justification for that. Certainly, we'll see some more of that as we go. Now your vocals come in at this point.
Oh, good.
Let's have a little listen to those.
You got your way like lullabies. Is that the lie that you hope for? The closing fist and the butterfly. Tell me that's the way that you want it.
Some really cool effects there. So there's obviously, actually, we can have a listen to just the vox effects. We've got like a backwards reverb and some throws.
Cool.
Nice. So cool. Man, best stems. Cheers. Thank you, Jens. Thank you very much. The idea is like this is a really spat kind of vocal, right? Like this is the kind of thing that we would augment rather than with a harmony with whisper tracks or spoken tracks or whatever else.
Trails. I suppose the focus of it is a more rhythmic thing because it like melodically isn't doing that much, you know, but it's sort of it's driving along with the pulse of the and against the pulse of the bass.
Yeah, actually, could we do, let's do vocals, drums, and bass.
You got your way like lullabies. Is that the lie that you hope for? The closing fist and the butterfly. Tell me that's the way that you want it.
Yeah, I love that drum fill. All right, so admittedly, it's actually better.
Yeah, that's as it was intended, I think.
Yeah. No, but it's really interesting how, I mean, your vocal there kind of sits in a lot of the spaces of the bass. It's kind of all tied together by that constant eighth note figure that comes in on the guitars and the keyboard. When we're putting parts like this together, definitely the idea is that we're not getting in one another's way. You know, it can be pretty complicated, but as long as everything has kind of its own little space, especially in a rhythmic sense, I think it works really well. Let's have a listen to those guitars.
You can hear a hint of that guitar melody in the keys, but majority of it.
Well, if you go down to the stems, I think it might even be that same hybrid keys sound we heard in the intro that's kind of outlining, and again, just adding a little bit more attack and a little bit more space to it. I think, verse keys, it'll be the one. It's cool. It could even be Unicorn. Oh, and your DX7, yeah.
That was one of those last minute additions we did in that last couple of days.
It's great though. It sounds awesome. So obviously what's happening here is that we've got like a dotted eighth note kind of pattern, like a U2-esque approach to kind of guitar construction. I really like the idea that if we've got all of these angular rhythms happening between the bass and the drums and certainly the vocals as well, the guitar's kind of just holding down the rhythmic fort. It's sitting there with the hi-hat. So Josh is playing like a straight set of 16ths on the hi-hat as well. And all together, you kind of get this almost pad-like effect. You know, all of the stabs are happening on top of it, but it's not really creating a huge amount of rhythmic emphasis beyond just that da-da-da-da-da-da-da kind of, you know, keeping the beat hi-hat type feel. Let's put some of those together. Maybe have a listen to the drums and the guitars, perhaps. Yeah, it's kind of cool. Like the more rhythmically stable they are and dynamically repetitive, because I mean, like all of those notes are the same velocity, same dynamic, right? They end up kind of being pushed into the background because of that, I think, which is really cool. It lets the bass shine. It lets obviously the vocals are the hero of the section.
Yay.
Let's face it, vocals are like half hero alongside the bass.
Yeah.
Jim's always the hero.
Thank you.
Yeah, totally. That bass tone. What was your onomatopoeia for the bass tone?
I think this was like maybe a week deep into tracking, so it doesn't actually make sense. But I think it was plutz.
You say that doesn't make sense, dude. I can hear the plutz.
You can hear plutz in this?
That's plutz.
Plutz.
It's pure plutz. Yeah, it's a lot of fun. It really does kind of end up being... I mean, it's the lead instrument. Certainly, it's still subordinate to the vocal, but man. So what did we do there?
So we had Dale's XFX preset. Was it an Ampeg one that we were using? No, Messer.
I think it's a Messer, the F400 or whatever
it is. So this is just his amp sound. a lot of the clank. I believe from memory we used API preamp 512 with the 1176 and actually my dark glass hyperluminal compressor that I had.
Oh, dude, that was like the secret. That was incredible.
The bottom end, keeping everything really tight together.
I would swear by that thing now.
So we listened to them together. And then we went through afterwards and we were using a mix of parallax for the heavier sections, and then I have a dark glass vintage microtubes, I think it is, for the verses. So the parallax, which is just chaos.
Yeah, no, we should point out, obviously, all of the bass is filtered out of that. This is like a parallel crunchy distortion alongside the other things. And that's true also with this.
So when you blend it in.
Yeah.
You can hear how it kind of just like tightens everything up when it gets to the verse by dropping it from the really crazy parallax. But we found that when we were tracking, the dark glass wasn't giving us enough energy and grit for the bigger sections.
And parallax is incredible too. But I mean, that was certainly a sound that we tailored alongside all of those rhythm guitars, like just kind of working out how we can, like what spaces, you know, what sort of sonic spaces do we have to place the bass so that it really has a character of its own. It was actually something that, I mean, I remember Dale, you know, really, check face. We did. I remember very early on Dale sort of saying like he really wants to have a bit of a sonic signature on this record, and it really does. You know, it's not to say that, there's not a lot of people obviously using similar kind of bass distortion tones, but we tailored everything here, like the guitar sounds and the bass sounds. We tailored them all to kind of fit together into this one sonic whole. And I'm really happy with it. Like even when I listen to it now, it's great, I think.
And I think too, like song to song, you know, we kept tweaking parallax and okay, this song needs a bit more, a bit less, and same with the dark glass and whatnot. And then when we gave it to Jens, you can see here we've made like what we think is going to sound the best for each section, but we didn't get rid of the in-between so that if he felt, oh, actually, I can do more with the dark glass, or I can do more with the parallax in this section.
Let's have a listen to the bass stem from there going to there. Let's see if he actually used that. Be interesting.
Hey, it did change.
Cool. Yeah. All right, so
did keep, well,
high five, we did something right.
Our choices worked.
All right, so let's have a look at the lift from the verse through to the pre-chorus. Now, this, I think, embodies something that we strive for a lot, right, Jim? Like this idea of kind of terraced like jumps and dynamics, which hopefully continue to surprise you, right?
Yeah, going to what you might think is like exploding into a chorus and then hitting you again, you know, with another chorus after that. So often, you know, things will be labeled in a session that are just like chorus 1A.
Yeah, chorus 1B.
Verse 1A.
That kind of thing. So, yeah. I mean, I would consider all of this bit, like from There's No Saints onwards, to be, you know, a form of the chorus, but obviously it's built as a pre-chorus, chorus kind of thing.
Totally agree. Couldn't agree more. Ooh, there's no saints, save for the strength to stand. I mean, in doing that, there's obviously some interesting arrangement kind of bass challenges, because it's like, you know, Jim is right up there at this. I mean, the tessiture of the song is pretty nuts.
I think it's the most significantly kind of repetitively high thing we have.
Yeah.
In full voice, sort of.
It's definitely up there, isn't it? But I mean, like, being that dynamic is kind of locked at a 10 there, everything else is designed to, you know, hopefully lift it that little bit more in the chorus. So one obvious way we approach that is to do vocal harmonies, particularly like vocal harmonies that in a melodic sense follow the lead line but just support it. But in addition to that, we're always thinking about things like feel changes. You know, it's a really big one. Obviously playing with things like the width of the stereo spectrum, like what is jumping in, you know, around the farther sides of your left and right kind of hearing experience. And let's have a look at that transition from sort of the end of pre-chorus one to chorus one. Okay, let's see, what is this?
Yeah.
This is probably one of my sine subs, I think, isn't it? Ooh, that's a cool one.
It's not a metal or prog metal record without some kind of sub drop somewhere.
I still remember writing the mixing notes for Jens and apologising. I just feel like, look, it's kind of cheesy. There's a lot of that stuff, but anyway. So let's have a listen to drums, guitars, and bass, if you don't mind. Just rhythm guitars.
something that's cool to note, and I remember when we were tracking drums for this down at Studio Circuit, Josh has this innate ability to really lay into the downbeat of each bar. And I remember, and I mean, you can even see it even in Jens's mixes. You know, we've got our downbeat here and around here and there. So one, awesome job from Jens to maintain the dynamics of the drums and still make them feel, you know, hyper, like, energetic and whatnot. But, yeah, Josh just, like, that's all Josh. That's, he's coming in on those downbeats and he's really laying into the kick drum there.
That really makes me, I mean, there's something that's definitely worth addressing there, which is just the general production aesthetic of Caligula's Horse, not even the song, but of a lot of our music. This kind of idea of, you know, you want it to sound as big and as powerful as possible in a production sense, but we take very seriously the idea that, like, these are performances, even in their final form. And if you listen to that drum stem, I mean, you know, there's probably a little bit of sample enhancement there, but it really does sound like Josh playing. And that's a really important part. And I mean, you can hear that awesome room down at Studio Circuit, that crazy cupboard mic and all that stuff.
While we talk about those rooms,
let's have a look at those, shall we?
Oops.
So this might sound a little bit, just by comparison, a little bit kind of weak now, but this is the drums with absolutely no processing. I think we've got a bit of gating and stuff like that on there.
Oh, why has that started back there?
Look at that.
There's that downbeat I was talking about. Now, yeah, you know, awesome. In terms of our room mics, Studio Circuit has this really awesome chamber, which is like this tall ceiling,
awesome.
It's brick, Besser block bricks or something room with nothing, and it's just like, chaos.
Yeah, and you can really hear that in those mixes too, just kind of really filling in the snare, giving it that little bit of kind of breath, I suppose.
So while we're here, maybe we should talk about our overhead arrangement that we had for this, because I feel like a lot of the track, obviously in this kind of music, like, close mics on the drums are super important, but also having that kind of width and space from our overheads is really important. And I know that you and I like different things, and I feel like we managed to make the best of both of those work.
Yeah, I couldn't be happier. I mean, there's a lot of stuff here that isn't really as I'd normally do it. But, you know, when we started planning the production for this, obviously we wanted to cover all of our bases. What I usually like to do, especially in a bigger production I'm working on, is do two sets of overheads, kind of more as like an XOR, you know what I mean? Like, we're going to use this one or we're going to use this one depending on the circumstances. But in this case, Jared and I kind of, well, we spent a couple of hours definitely just getting these as close as they could be in terms of phase, and they ended up working surprisingly well alongside one another.
For sure. So we had first up, we had a spaced pair, which is generally my sort of go to that, and we used a pair of 414s into some 1084s down there, and that sounds like this.
Nice clean, nice and wide.
And then to blend in with that, we did Sam's favourite trick, which is the ORTF. What is it, 90 degrees at 15
centimetres?
110. 110 degrees, yeah.
Something like that.
I know that it was like a shucker. You have them pointed away.
Right.
And so these were my Telefunken M60s, which I love to pieces, going through some Cappy preamps, and they sound like this.
I'll have to bring it up a little bit.
So I'm just going to quickly switch between the two, so space pair. So you can hear not only like depth and width kind of changes and what it's capturing changes, but the sonic signature of the two change. And what we found, just, I reckon, I'm not going to lie, probably by pure luck, we did a lot of measurement and we did a lot of making sure they're in phase with each other, but together they really surprised us at how good it sounded.
Yeah, so I mean, it's sort of, the ORTF is obviously a little tiny bit less stereo, well, let's say a decent amount less stereo than the sort of the space pair, but together it just sort of felt like it filled everything in, and it
filled
didn't,
in what
you know,
was
lose
missing of the space pair. Yeah. With our kick drums, we used a D6, U47 FET, and a sub kick. And it doesn't actually sound like we've got any gating on that, and you know, there's very little bleed in anything. Same with our snare mics. I tend to favour a beta 57 over a normal 57 just for that off-axis rejection.
You've definitely sold me on that too.
For sure. And actually, my favourite Tom mics at the moment are, I've got a couple of M80s, a couple of M81s and one M80 from Telefunken. And these, to me, provide all the kind of punch and clarity that you'd expect from a MD421, a Sennheiser mic, but just so much more rejection. You know, and yeah, so they've got all the body, too. But you can hear a little bit of cymbals, which, Josh is just absolutely hammering his drum at this point.
Yeah, I mean, that's not for lack of Josh trying to make the cymbal spill.
But you get a really nice, crisp, clear version of the toms without too much cymbal bleed.
Mm. All right, well, let's have a look. So, I mean, in terms of the actual chorus, the other big lift is definitely the vocals. Mm. And this is a technique that we obviously use a lot. I mean, we're certainly not alone in using it, but creating harmonies that they kind of hide a little bit, I suppose, right? Like the idea is that they shouldn't be conspicuous. They should just fill in the chord structure. So let's have a listen to the vocals, maybe just.
There. Witness the riot, the rain, there's no saints, only the thunder and skin, the frailty, there's no saints. We are the rising cascade, the rolling wave, there's no saints.
So that's awesome. I want to add something to that. Just jump to the second chorus, if you would, Jared. So the variation here, it goes to this kind of like altered five chord.
Play the like that. Blame, the stone the same, there's no saints.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
That one was fun to record, actually. Yeah. It felt like a dirty
one. I love the idea that we can have these really colourful chords. Obviously, you can't really get away with having those on a distorted rhythm guitar. I mean, a lot of those parts are kind of power chords. Jim's voice ends up being, I'm going to say, probably the main carrier of the harmonic information of the track. And I mean, if you listen to those vocal harmonies, you know, there's like there's a weird half diminished chord in there. So there's a lot of color to it.
No saints, only the storm and the sin.
This one. Oh, sorry.
You tease.
The storm and the sin, the beauty.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. we sort of take. We take some liberties with what notes we could really get away with putting in here, right? I mean, certainly a lot of vocalists, it can be hard to place those dissonant notes in such a way that they don't become clangers, you know, they don't stand out. I think over the years, we've just gotten more and more risky with it.
Yeah, I stopped caring. give me that rub.
Yeah, yeah.
But no, the way I look at this is that, like, you know, for lack of me using any vocal, like distortion or heavy, like screamed kind of vocals, this is a way to, because that's not really in my wheelhouse at all. It's a way to kind of like give that amp up of, you know, that intensity and stuff without just going, let's sing higher and higher and more full, you know?
100%. As well as sounding really signature, I think, in a way, because when it comes to like those close seconds, you hear a lot of those, like harmonies that are traditionally very, very dissonant, you know, that stand out. They become a really conspicuous part of a lot of people's arrangements. Like if you use them, that's the part that everyone notices. But with us, it's kind of just the state of normalcy. Now, a really good example of this, just to jump ahead, is definitely the final bridge, where there's a lot more, well, there's a lot of temporary modulations and stuff. Like the harmony itself is really strange here. Let's have a listen to this. This is going to be fun.
The sea, the storm was always you. The call of the cascade. I see no God in here but you. The water, the cascade. And we could drown the world in truth. In concord, so dare I just let them set their fires, they'll find no witness. I swear by no saints.
Awesome. Very, very cool. I mean, that's a perfect example, isn't it? It's bizarre. Yeah.
That like second last kind of phrase right before the big note with it all just taking steps down is just like, I remember recording and going like, yeah.
Yeah, it's awesome. All right. Well, the only other thing that I think would be really cool to look at is the bridge section and the way it sort of moves from that soft motif through the guitar solo to that end bridge. So, I mean, structurally, this is definitely one of the simpler songs on the album. Mm. And actually, I should just point out, that's something that we, in the very early stages of creating this record, we talked about wanting those contrasts, right? Having a couple of songs that are a little more minimal in terms of their instrumentation, their dynamic. Slow Violence is probably the best example of that.
Yeah.
And songs that are a bit more dense and a bit more sort of, you know, crazy, surprising in their arrangement and in their structure.
And it was really sort of intentional to kind of go, you know, we already have a fairly fine-tooth comb when it comes to any excess in songs and like things that we don't think, you know, it served the song entirely. And we very much decided in that early discussion to go like, okay, we're going to be even tighter with that this time and kind of really focus on that structure and really focus on the directness of the song in a musical sense.
It's funny, after talking about the Eurosynth, me saying like, there's nothing here that shouldn't be. but it's kind of true. Let's have a listen to this anyway, because this whole end section, the point I was getting at is that this whole end section is basically a single motif, which is just developed a bunch of ways. There's the soft version, there's the guitar solo, and then there's that huge kind of vocal bridge outro before the final. We call it a chorus fake out.
Yeah.
Like a half chorus. Let's have a listen to just the clean guitars here and then maybe add the keys in, because it's a really cool arrangement, I think. Chuck the keys in. So, I mean, this is another one of these kind of like arrangement tricks. If you're playing with a bunch of very strange chords, it's kind of, I find it much more palatable to arrange those different voices, say across a couple of guitars, a couple of keys, maybe get certain intervals played only on certain instruments. I remember it being sort of like, I'm thinking Duke Ellington talking about like arranging big band where the dissonant instruments would be, the dissonant parts would be on the quieter instruments. I sort of take a similar view of this. So we've obviously got multiple octaves in the clean guitar of those same chords. You've got the synth bringing in a couple of like ninths and sharp fourths, like, you know, stranger kind of intervals. And then the lead part is obviously the main motif, which kind of ties it all together. But I really like this part. It's a really floaty kind of vibe, really unusual sense of harmonic color.
Definitely brings that optimistic vibe as well, coming out of what's been particularly dark for the basically all of the song up until that point. It has that nice change that you don't really expect coming into that.
Yeah, that's a really good point. See, I'm so in the pocket of big harmony that like I kind of lose how strange this is sometimes, but you're absolutely right. So obviously when it gets into the guitar solo, the rhythm guitar underneath this actually then takes that motif and moves it down, I think like down two octaves. Let's have a listen to that.
All the sludge.
Yeah. So stop that. So one of them is a guitar just doing like the power chords underneath it, but then you've also got a low version of that da-da-da-da, that kind of the little motif that happens all throughout there. And, you know, that kind of thing obviously goes under the radar a bit because it is a guitar solo section where that's kind of the hero of the part. But again, I have this idea, whether I'm right or not, I don't know, you guys can maybe tell me, that it's like the more of those kind of things that exist, maybe the more subconsciously you get this idea of coherence. You know what I mean? Maybe, maybe not. It certainly works in my mind.
Well, it definitely has like for me, it's like, the solo comes in and while the solo obviously is like MVP of the whole thing, it's what's sort of drawing your attention. With all of those things underneath, you still get like that lift of energy. Like all of these sections are going in it is a build that basically goes right up until that last No Saints. You know, it's just growing and growing and growing. And so having all of those other elements underneath gives this feeling of urgency.
Yeah.
Underneath the solo that's kind of leading you melodically to where we're going.
Yeah, very much so. And then, of course, the next lift happens by just widening out a bunch of those guitar parts. Obviously, the vocal harmonies become the main color. But yeah, I mean, that's something that I think in the arrangement we definitely take very seriously. You know, it's like we've got the motif hidden in there and we're just expanding its dynamic or expanding its harmonic color or whatever else. And the actual guitar solo tone is really nice too. Yen's chef's kiss. That's nice. It's all of the delay in China, right? Like, there's so much ambience going on there.
I love the little harmonies that just kind of come in just to accent a couple of the little phrases.
You know how hard my cheese meter is on those kind of things? Like it's got to be hidden. But actually, I mean, it's funny because that's a big part, maybe not so much in this song, but it's a big part of how we treat vocals normally. Certainly some that we'll look at maybe in some of the future songs, you know, just accentuating like a single line in the vocal or a single part in the melody.
I mean, particularly when it's in the softer kind of verse sections where we don't even necessarily do a double. It's just like, you know, it's like at the beginning of Salt, for example, it's just like basically one voice doing this really delicate thing and then highlighting, punctuating little things.
Well, I mean, besides that, it's kind of just repeats. This is a song that structurally we decided we didn't want to do like a big kind of third chorus, you know, recapitulation. We kind of wanted it to just be a short statement and end. So we did what we call a chorus fake out, in this case just being the No Saints line. I went into the end riff. I mean,
the biggest part of the song.
There was no getting away with not repeating that riff.
See, I often get bullied into repeating riffs because I actually like not repeating them much. I think of songs like All Is Quiet by the Wall where, you know, the main riff doesn't actually repeat at all.
Yeah, but you weren't listening to me then. You're beholden to my desires now.
That's true. But, I mean, it really is an example of, like, the song as with complete intention behind it doesn't outstay its welcome. You know, in progressive metal, there's definitely this kind of impulse towards making things as ornamental, as ornate, let's say, as they can be, right? Like lots of sections, lots of developments, lots of contrast.
Allowing that sort of adventurous approach, you know, just like, let's go on a little trek together.
Now, we, of course, do that as well. But you know, in shorter songs, it's really important to me that it's like once the statement is made, the song ends. Yeah, you know, it's the reason that I like my guitar solos to be quite short for the most part. It's the reason that I like economy in repeats. I'd much rather take an idea as a motif and sort of hide it in a lot of different places rather than hammer it down 4 times, 5 times throughout a song. And this song, I don't think you could get a better example of that. You know, the fact that we don't even kind of have a final chorus, we instead treat the main riff as the, I suppose, like the dynamic climax.
And even within that, when we do repeat, I mean, from a vocal perspective, which is all I have, the you know, like when we do repeat like the pre-chorus and have an identical something, you know, back-to-back within a song like this, the lyrics change as well. Mm-hmm. Like the pre-chorus and the second time has a different list of things that it's referencing. And we do that quite often, and much to my own chagrin when it comes live and I just forget where I am, what city I'm in, what day it is, and what the lyrics to the song are.
Well, we're 5 albums deep. It's only downhill.
Yeah.
It's only getting worse.
Just getting older. I don't remember the beginning of this whole thing today.
Where am I right now? Well, with that, should we leave this one?
Yeah. That's the Tempest,
Let's
everybody.
Play it out.
Yay. Nah, it's all about that synth.